بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of God, the gracious, the merciful. We are going to speak about vascular surgery, lesson number 2. This will be on veins and lymphatics. We will start by disorders of veins. Two main disorders are going to be discussed today, which are varicose veins and venous thromboembolism. There are several clinical types and variants of varicosities that may affect either dermal varicosities, subcutaneous veins, or sometimes they are so extensive and non-anatomical. Dermal varicosities occur due to varicose dilatation of subdermal plexus of venules. It gives the shape of a spider. Subcutaneous varicosities may be in the form of serpentine veins, and serpentine means snake-like, bending like a snake. These are dilated, elongated, tortuous veins. These usually affect the long and or the short saphenous veins. The second type present in the subcutaneous vein is blowout. Blowout is a hemispherical varicosity, usually occurs due to underlying incontinent perforators. Sometimes we see hemispherical varicosity at the region of the refluxing saphenofemoral junction, producing what's called as saphena varix, which is a blowout at the saphenofemoral junction. The last variant is extensive non-anatomical varicosities, and this usually occurs in conjunction with arteriovenous malformation. This is a rare syndrome known as Klippel-Trenet syndrome. Let's see the photo of the first type, which is dermal varicosities. Dermal varicosities appear like spider, and this may be seen on the back of the knee as this patient, or on the side of the knee like that patient. It shows thin varicosities and they are branching like a spider. The blowout is a hemispherical varicosity, usually at the site of a known perforator. Refluxing underlying perforator will push blood toward a specific point at the subcutaneous veins. This site with time will yield under pressure and will undergo ballooning, and it will give the appearance of a hemispherical varicosity, which is known as blowout. The same idea occurs at an incontinent saphenofemoral junction. This is the saphena varix. And as you see, the great saphenous is serpentine and it is ending in this incontinent saphenofemoral junction. This is serpentine varicosities affecting the great saphenous vein. It is bending and tortuous and dilated, like you see in this photo. This is the great saphenous in the thigh. Varicosities may be in awkward, abnormal sites, like in front of the leg. This occurs due to dilatation of veins to collateralize obstructed veins, or due to high venous pressure, which opens small veins which normally do not appear. This is the short saphenous varicosities, and it is serpentine-like. And please notice that the short saphenous varicosities end at the back of the knee, because at this particular site, the short saphenous enter the popliteal and disappear from the subcutaneous plane. Another example of varicosities are that occurring on the anterior abdominal wall. This is a case of dilated anterior abdominal wall subcutaneous veins. We may see this either in portal hypertension, and in this situation, these veins are spreading out like sun rays from the umbilicus. And this is called caput medusa. And in some cases of inferior vena cava obstruction, collateralization of blood from the lower extremity and pelvis are dilated to mediate blood from the lower part of the body to the upper part to gain access to the superior vena cava to reach the heart. So, if you have anterior abdominal wall, venous dilatation, varicosities, think of either caput medusa due to portal hypertension or inferior vena cava obstruction. This is an arteriovenous malformation. You see the varicosities start at the gluteal region, affecting abnormal site on the lateral aspect of the thigh, around the knee and the upper leg. And this is the radiological appearance of this case, in which you see the normal arterial tree and the plexiform venous plexus that involves the whole lower limb from top to bottom. Investigations of varicose veins may be done by performing contrast venography or duplex venography or CT angiography. Please observe the subcutaneous serpentine veins in the medial aspect of the knee, especially on the left side. This is done by injecting contrast inside a subcutaneous vein. Another case that show dilatation of the deep venous system with sacculation at the site of valves. Observe also, this is the femoropopliteal segment of veins, and this is varicosities affecting the popliteal vein behind the knee. Of course, this technique can delineate varicosities, but this technique is invasive, and it may be complicated by phlebitis and aggravation of venous problems. So this technique is not used nowadays. Please observe this duplex venography, in which you will see the vein here is markedly dilated. And please notice the thin venous valves here. I'll run this video, and please notice this area in which the valves will be opening and closing with blood flow. Treatment of varicosities depend to a great extent on the state of deep venous system. If the deep venous system is patent, you can deal with the superficial veins easily. But if the deep system is occluded, don't touch the superficial system because it is the only system that mediate venous return from the lower limb. So the first important thing to be considered is assessment of patency of the deep system, usually by using duplex venography. If it is patent, start managing the superficial system. For spider veins, it is enough to inject a sclerosant material by a small needle, and this is sufficient to obliterate the veins because this procedure is only done for cosmetic reasons. But for large varicose veins, several techniques may be used, like endovenous radiofrequency ablation, endovenous laser ablation, or surgical stripping. If you have blowouts, which signify incontinent perforators, you have to ligate these perforators in the subfascial plane, and you have to disconnect these perforators from the superficial system. So ligate the superficial system above and below the level of the affected perforator. So this operation is known as triple ligature. For saphenovarix, signifying saphenofemoral incontinence, you can perform Klendelenburg operation, which includes disconnection of the great saphenous from the femoral vein, as well as ligation of 4 or 5 small veins that enter the great saphenous just prior to its communication with the femoral. This is known as Trendelenburg operation. If you have venous ulcer, which signifies high venous pressure in the deep system with reflux of blood through the direct perforators present in the lower third of the leg, you have to control these perforators either by injection or by subfascial ligation. Now let's speak about venous thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. Etiology of venous thrombosis includes stasis of venous flow, coagulation disorders, and endothelial damage. Venous stasis is produced by immobilization. We are confronted with this problem after surgical procedures, after trauma, after stroke due to loss of consciousness, and patients stay in coma and non-mobile for a long time. After fractures, patients cannot move around. In long travels, like 12 hours, 15 hours flight. And in cardiopulmonary failure, in which condition the patient cannot move adequately. Also, venous stasis occur if the venous valves are damaged and refluxing, so the blood are not effectively drained from the tissues. The blood undergo the so-called yo-yo movement. It go towards the heart with muscle contraction and return back to the tissue with muscle relaxation. And it is not properly drained, and the veins will be congested and the blood will be static. Also, we are confronted with venous stasis in cases of obesity, pregnancy, and malignancy. The second cause of venous thrombosis is a coagulation disorder. It may be due to increased coagulability or decreased coagulability. In hypercoagulable states, there may be increased antiphospholipid antibody, increased platelet count or activity, and in hormone therapy, especially contraceptive pills. Some hypocoagulability states may produce coagulation disorder that lead to venous thrombosis, like decreased antithrombin 3, protein S and protein C. This hypocoagulability factors, if are deficient, they will produce coagulation. Also, plasminogen activator inhibitor increase will produce coagulation disorder. The last factors all normally induce coagulation balance with the normal coagulation mechanism. So, if this balance is disturbed, coagulation will result. The last factor is induction of endothelial damage by introduction of catheters intravenously or direct trauma to the veins or chemical trauma to the veins by drug injection like chemotherapy, like antibiotics, like non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, like fluids that contain potassium. Diagnosis of venous thrombosis in the lower limb is simple. The patient usually presents with pain and swelling due to edema and congestion. Rarely, the patient may have specific tenderness, especially with muscle contraction. And this situation can be solved and clarified easily by performing duplex venography for the lower limb veins. However, in the past, we thought of venous thrombosis in the lower limb as a separate entity from pulmonary embolism. However, recently we recognized that 40% of cases affected by deep vein thrombosis in the lower limb or pelvis will have in the same time pulmonary embolism without producing pulmonary symptoms, the so-called silent pulmonary embolism. And that's why we consider venous thrombosis is not a separate entity from pulmonary embolism. In every single case of venous thrombosis, you have to think about the possibility of having pulmonary embolism in the same time. Only 4% of cases of deep vein thrombosis will symptomatize by pulmonary embolism. That's why in every single case, you have to bear in mind that your case might have associated pulmonary embolism. You have to consider in every single post-operative patient the possibility of pulmonary embolism because the incidence is around 1%, especially if the patient has risk factors like obesity, like malignancy, like prolonged operation, like disturbance in the fluid balance, like improper positioning on table, etc. Lastly, you have to remember that pulmonary embolism is not necessarily fatal from the first time. It is rare to have massive pulmonary embolism as an index or first symptom. Usually, pulmonary embolism occurs as repeated minor attacks. This clinical entity is known as showering. Pulmonary embolism occurs for several times, then the pulmonary bed is occluded sequentially, progressively, till the pulmonary circulation completely arrested and impeded, and patient may die. But usually the fatal type of pulmonary embolism is not from the first attack. That's why we have to be cautious in every single patient with venous thrombosis that this case might develop pulmonary embolism. How to diagnose pulmonary embolism? The most important clinical manifestations that are present in around 90% of patients are dyspnea and tachypnea. Other manifestations may be present, but these are the most consistent presentations. Laboratory investigations include several tests. However, one of the most sensitive and specific tests is estimation of the so-called fibrinogen degradation product, D-dimer assessment. If it is high, this indicates high possibility of venous thrombosis and or pulmonary embolism. Estimation of arterial blood gases usually reveal hypoxia with metabolic acidosis. And in some cases, the partial carbon dioxide tension may be normal, except in massive pulmonary embolism. ECG show usually right heart strain, as evident by large P wave, right axis deviation, and or inverted T wave. This is an important sign because it signifies a significant occlusion of the pulmonary bed. Duplex venography of the lower lip is mandatory to exclude the source of pulmonary embolism. Usually it is from the pelvis or lower limb. That's why you have to scan the iliac veins, the femoral veins, and the popliteal veins. It is uncommon to have pulmonary embolism with distal type of venous thrombosis. So you have to search for the proximal venous circulation to assess venous thrombosis in cases of pulmonary embolism, not the distal. We search for the proximal veins. CT pulmonary angio is the gold standard of diagnosis, as it shows clearly the minor, the moderate, and the major pulmonary emboli. Management of pulmonary embolism and venous thrombosis can be summarized in the following slide. Number one, for severe cases with pulmonary embolism, you have to start supportive treatment immediately. You have to give oxygen to the patient, either by nasal catheter or mask, or even in some conditions, you may need intubation and ventilation. If the patient presents with shock, that's to say blood pressure below 90, you have to give vasoactive drugs like norepinephrine plus minus dupetamine. In these particular patients, you have to insert central venous line and cautiously start the fluid therapy, because you know that fluid therapy has two potentials. A positive potential that will make blood thinner and avoid further thrombosis. But also fluid therapy has a negative potential because it may induce further burden to the pulmonary circulation and to the strained heart. The next step is to give active therapy to treat thrombosis. You may start the thrombolytic therapy for 2 hours at the start of treatment. This can be done in cases of pulmonary embolism and also in venous thrombosis of the limbs if it is massive and proximal. But be cautious, that is contraindicated if cases have associated myocardial infarction and or bleeding tendency. After 2 hours, you can start heparin therapy for 5 to 10 days. Heparin has several types. The most commonly used type now is low molecular weight heparin. Another drug now is in its infancy in use is anti-factor 10A. There are several drugs that inhibit factor 10. And they are used now, and they are easy to use because they are in the form of oral tablets. However, though they proved their efficacy, but they are not used for a long time, so long-term results are awaited to standardize their use in cases of pulmonary embolism. After ending the phase of heparin or anti-10 treatment, you may resort to long-term treatment by oral anticoagulants like coumadins. You have to use them for at least 3 to 6 months, and you may increase this period to 1 year in massive cases of DVT affecting proximal veins, in cases presenting with pulmonary embolism, and in cases which are recurring. Sometimes in high-risk patients, oral anticoagulants may be used indefinitely for life. Please don't forget to use elastic compression stockings for the lower limbs. Special treatment may be used for certain high-risk cases, which includes, number one, insertion of IVC filter, inferior vena cava filter. The inferior vena cava filter maintains the inferior vena cava blood flow, but stops emboli more than 4 millimeter diameter. Thus, even if thrombosis and embolism occur, the emboli will be showers, will be minor, and will not be massive emboli which are life-threatening. The indications of insertion of IVC filter are, number one, if anticoagulation is absolutely contraindicated, like a case with bleeding tendency or myocardial infarction. Number two, if patient experience recurring venous thromboembolism. Number three, if high-risk patient experience a single attack of pulmonary embolism, please don't let your fragile patient experience another attack. Insert a filter. Rarely, we may resort to direct attack of the thrombus and or embolus by catheter or surgical removal. These maneuvers are risky and they are not very successful. They necessitate great experience and they may be followed by massive bleeding or shock, arrhythmia, and other complications. This is a duplex venography that show the vein here. This is the femoral vein. This is the femoral vein. And this vein is patent at this region and it is filled with an echogenic shadow. This echogenic shadow is the venous thrombosis. It is filling the whole lumen. This is another duplex venography that show the popliteal vein. And this is the superficial vein, which is the short saphenous vein running in the subcutaneous tissue. Then this is the junction of the short saphenous with the popliteal. So the deep vein is intact and the junctional area is also intact. Observe the short saphenous vein. It is filled with an echogenic material, which is thrombosis of the short saphenous vein. Another case with duplex venography that show an a thrombus that is filling the short saphenous popliteal junction. This is the thrombus, and as you see, blood is stagnant after the thrombus because start of occlusion of the venous return will make the flow sluggish, and this will start occlusion of the popliteal within a short period of time. This is stagnation of blood. This is stagnation of blood. This is stagnation of blood. And all of this are provoked and induced by this thrombus that impeded the flow. Let's see now some CT pulmonary angio pictures in order to be able to read the CT pulmonary angiography and diagnose pulmonary embolism. This is the aorta, this is the main pulmonary trunk, and this is the right branch, and this is the left branch, and these are the peripheral branches of pulmonary circulation. This is a normal CT pulmonary angio. Please observe the branches of the pulmonary circulation in order to be able to diagnose pulmonary embolism. This is the main pulmonary trunk, and this is the bifurcation of the pulmonary trunk to right and left. As you see, this appearance is near total occlusion of the left and right pulmonary as well as the bifurcation area. This is called saddle pulmonary embolism. This saddle embolism is occluding the right and left pulmonary vessels near completely. In this case, the main pulmonary trunk is patent. The right pulmonary trunk also is patent, but there is a thrombus here or an embolus that occludes part of the right pulmonary artery, and another one here is partially occluding the left pulmonary artery. So this is bilateral pulmonary embolism occluding the left and right pulmonary arteries and sparing, leaving the main pulmonary trunk intact. This is an isolated embolus that blocks the right pulmonary artery nearly completely, and the left is patent and the main trunk is also patent. So this is a case of right pulmonary embolism. This is a different situation. Observe the minor emboli here that are present bilaterally, and this side also, on the right side, there are minor emboli of the peripheral pulmonary vessels. This is the so-called peripheral pulmonary embolism. These cases usually are not associated with massive hemodynamic instability. This is the picture of the IVC filter. It is usually inserted transjugular in a retrograde direction, and it is placed below the renal vein, and the arms or wings of the filter are opened and are attached to the inner side of the inferior vena cava wall. As we know, of course, insertion of this filter includes injection of intravenous contrast, and any contrast, intravascular contrast injection, will delineate usually the kidney, and this is the right kidney, which appears like as we do intravenous urography. In this particular situation, this case has associated hydroureter, hydropelvis, and hydrocalcosis, the so-called hydronephrosis. This is just an association. If patient developed deep vein thrombosis of the lower limb, the deep system is destroyed either by blockage due to organization of the thrombus despite attempts of thrombus dissolution by drugs or by natural physiological recanalization process. Sometimes veins do not open and they are permanently occluded by fibrous organization of fibrous tissue. Or if canalization occurred and succeeded, usually this process do not spare intact venous valves. And valves, if destroyed, reflux of veins occur and the blood is congested in the lower limb, inducing the so-called venous hypertension. Cases after phlebitis, after deep vein thrombosis, will develop a syndrome known as post-phlebitic syndrome. Post-phlebitic syndrome or post-thrombotic syndrome. In this situation, especially proximal venous DVT, the incidence of this syndrome is around 25% after 2 years, but it increases with time to reach around 70% after 7 to 10 years. In post-phlebitic syndrome, as we said, there is persistent venous hypertension and reflux of blood in the reverse direction towards the tissues, not toward the blood. The venous blood is flowing toward tissues and not toward blood. This venous hypertension can exceed that of the arterial inflow pressure, and it stops the peripheral circulation and induces actual ischemic changes of the tissue. Thus, We commonly see in this situation tissue degeneration and trophic changes exactly like we see in ischemia cases. This is an example of a venous ulcer. The venous ulcer in post-flebitic syndrome usually occur in the lower third of the leg because it is the most dependent part with the highest venous pressure. Number two, perforators of this region are direct perforators from the deep system to the dermal venules. There is no intervening superficial venous communication as in the upper part of the leg. In the upper part of the leg, perforators that communicate the subdermal plexus to the deep system do not drain blood directly to the deep system. Perforators of the upper leg drain blood from the skin to the superficial system, then from the superficial system to the deep system. So venous hypertension of the upper leg is buffered to a great extent by refluxing into a wide plexus of subcutaneous veins. So the dermal venules of the upper leg do not suffer much. The situation in the lower leg differs a lot. The refluxing blood from the deep system is going directly to the skin and subcutaneous tissue without an intermediate buffer circulation of subcutaneous veins. And thus, the trophic changes are marked in the lower third of the leg. In most of the cases, the ulcer is on the medial aspect, around 88%, but sometimes we see venous ulcer in post-flebitic syndrome on the lateral aspect in less than 12% of cases. The second problem is the presence of pigmentation. As you see, the limb is congested from venous hypertension, venous congestion, dermal backflow of veins, sluggish capillary circulation, and cyanosis. Not only this, but also hemosiderosis, because venous hypertension induces rupture of dermal venules, liberation of blood cells. Erythrocytes will disintegrate, liberating hemoglobin that contains iron, and this will induce hemosiderosis and dark pigmentation. So the color of the post-flebitic limb is usually congested from venous stasis and dark purple due to hemosiderosis. Another nearly constant sign is the presence of edema due to improper drainage of the tissues, because not only the veins are hypertensive due to blockage, but commonly the lymphatics may be also associated in the process of venous occlusion by lymphatic occlusion. Lymphatics may also thrombose. Lymphatics may also be occluded because lymphatics at the end will drain inside veins. So edema is nearly a constant sign in post-flebitic syndrome. Another sign is present here. It is dermatitis or eczema. This is called venous dermatitis or venous eczema, and this is also due to starting irritation by hemosiderosis. Another example of venous thrombosis may be found deep in the viscera. We will give some examples of thrombosis in sites other than the periphery. This is a CT angio of the abdomen in the coronal view, it shows the spleen here with the splenic vein arising from the hilum, communicating with the superior mesenteric vein to form the portal vein. There is an echogenic structure here. This dark appearance occluding the main stem of the portal vein at the hilum of the liver is marked by this red star or asterisk. This is thrombosis of the main trunk of portal vein, inducing acute portal hypertension. This is a CT with contrast in the axial view or the transverse cut. It shows the kidneys. They are well enhanced due to intravascular contrast injection. This is the aorta. This is the IVC. In front of the IVC, this structure is the superior mesenteric vein. In front of the aorta, this is the superior mesenteric artery. The superior mesenteric artery is visualized, filled with contrast and normal. However, the superior mesenteric vein is filled only partially with contrast, and there is a filling defect here, which is a thrombosis of the superior mesenteric vein. Another uncommon variant of venous thrombosis is cavernous sinus thrombosis. Any inflammatory process in the dangerous area of the face, which is this triangle, including the nose and the medial part of the cheek and upper lip, this inflammatory process may be transmitted through emissary veins to the cavernous sinus deeply, producing cavernous sinus thrombophlebitis, as pointed to by this arrowhead, the white arrowhead here. This is the thrombus of the cavernous. Observe the size of the globe here and there. The size of the globe here is much, much enlarged due to congestion and the edema. And this is the clinical picture of this poor lady. The second vascular system that we are going to be elucidating is disorders of lymphatic system. Disorders of lymphatic system includes lymphangioma, which is a hamartoma of lymphatic tissue, cases of lymphedema, which is edema due to lymphatic blockage or reflux, tumors arising from lymphatic channels and lymph nodes, and lastly, an uncommon disorder known as chyluria, which is presence of chyle in the urine. This is lymphangioma of the skin, the so-called cutaneous lymphangioma. Cutaneous lymphangioma, as you see, appear as vesicles in the dermis with some pigmentation, and these vesicles are gathered in a cluster, like a group, in a cluster. As you see, it's a cluster or a group of variable-sized vesicles. This is usually a congenital disorder, but rarely it appears late in the adulthood. Another form of lymphangioma is lymphangioma of deep lymphatics. It produces a lymphatic cyst. One of the common sites of lymphatic cyst is the neck. In this situation, it is called the cystic hygroma or cystic hydroma because it is filled with a thin, clear fluid like water. And that's why it is called cystic hydroma or hygroma. The problem of this cyst is it produces deflection, head turn to the contralateral side. And this produces something like a torticollis. This cyst, if it is present intrauterine, the baby during labor will suffer from obstructed labor because his head will be extended backwards and he will present a biface presentation instead of vertex presentation. This is after excision of the cyst. As you see, it's a large multilocular cyst filled with clear fluid. Please observe that this cyst of the neck may have another component in the axilla. And this component exhibits cross fluctuation with that of the neck. If the condition is so, please don't forget to excise the two components, otherwise recurrence will occur. This is a case of extensive lymphedema of the left upper limb. Lymphedema of the limbs may be primary due to lymphatic disorder, which may present early after labor, and this is known as lymphedema congenita, or maybe delayed till the age of puberty, and it is called the lymphedema precox, or maybe delayed till adulthood, and this is called lymphedema tarda. This occurs due to lymphatic aplasia, or hypoplasia, or lymphatic channels reflux. Another type of lymphedema, also of the left upper limb, is recognized in this situation. Please compare the left and right upper limbs. This form is a secondary lymphedema of the upper limb due to extensive resection of lymph nodes and blockage of lymphatic drainage of the upper limb among an operation of breast cancer known as modified radical mastectomy. This is a secondary lymphedema case. This is a lymphangiography done by the classic technique. Usually we inject a certain contrast in the lymphatics. This is the upper limb. We inject the contrast in the dorsum of the hand or in the cleft between fingers. And we observe the lymphatics. As you see, the lymphatics in the region of the elbow and in the forearm are plexiform and dilated. Compare this to that normal lymphatic channel. This is lymphangiectasia. The lymphatics here are ectatic, dilated, and plexiform. They are abnormal. This is another case of primary lymphedema, but affecting the lower limb. It affects the thigh, the leg, as well as the foot. This is another case of bilateral lymphedema. In bilateral cases, please consider secondary lymphedema. Consider hypoalbuminemia, consider static edema, consider cardiac edema, consider renal edema, consider hepatic lymph edema. This is another form of lower limb lymphedema. It is extensive lymphedema. However, please notice the transverse scar in the groin. This scar is groin surgery to resect lymph nodes in the groin in case of malignant lymphoma or some pelvic malignancy like malignancy of the bladder or pelvic organs, in which we sometimes remove the lymph nodes of the internal as well as the external iliac lymphatics. This will induce secondary lymphedema of the relevant lymph. This is a conventional lymphangiography that show the thin lymphatic channels and they are inserted into the groin lymph nodes. Another case, please compare the right side with the left side. The right side show thin lymphatics. They are around 3 or 4. And here, though they are thin lymphatics, but they are multiple lymphatics. They are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. These are more than that side. This is a magnetic resonance lymphography. It's a very accurate method to diagnose borderline cases which are not clearly evident by lymphangiography. The advantage of this technique is it is a non-invasive technique because injection of contrast inside lymphatics may induce lymphangitis and lymphatic blockage. This may aggravate the situation, may increase the lymphedema. MR lymphangiography is non-invasive and do not produce deterioration of the condition. And in addition, it shows, as you see, extensive lymphatic dilatation and diastasis. Here you see a plexus of lymphatic channels. They are dilated, they are hyperplastic, they increase in size, and this is a massive accumulation of lymph of this region. Compare this pathological site to that normal site. Now let's speak about tumors arising from lymphatic tissue. Usually tumors arising from lymphatic tissue are either lymphoma arising from lymph nodes or arising from solid organs or gut. They may be Hodgkin or non-Hodgkin lymphoma. But please, let's speak about special types of lymphoma, such as Burkitt's lymphoma. Burkitt's lymphoma is famous in Africa in particular, and this may be due to the prevalence, the frequent occurrence of malaria and Epstein-Barr virus infection producing glandular fever. These two conditions, malaria and glandular fever, may predispose to the development of this aggressive type of lymphoma known as Burkitt's lymphoma. Observe this child with affection of the right side of the head and neck. This case with massive involvement of the face, the submandibular region, and the neck with a very large lymphomatous aggressive mass. And another case of this African child involving the right side of the face, globe, and cheek. Some examples about presentation of lymphoma. One of the important presentations of lymphoma is lymphadenopathy in the left supraclavicular region in particular. This is called Virchow's sign. Supraclavicular adenopathy on the left side may indicate infradiaphragmatic malignancy coming from the abdomen and or pelvis, because secondaries may embolize through lymphatics, and you know that the cervical thoracic duct enter the junction between the left jugular and left subclavian vein. This site may be blocked and retrograde lymphatic spread to the supraclavicular nodes may occur, producing this characteristic Virchow's sign. So when you have a case of left supraclavicular adenopathy, please consider infradiaphragmatic malignancy. Also, it may occur due to left-sided chest disorders, or it may be primary lymphadenopathy. This small mass in the left axilla also may be enlarged in several conditions. However, it may be a primary lymphadenopathy or secondary lymphadenopathy. This particular area, please consider the breast, the chest, the back, and don't forget the upper limb. This is the sternomastoid, and these lymph nodes are in the posterior triangle. This is a famous site for lymphoma. Please consider the diagnosis of lymphoma if you have lymph nodes in the neck, and the only solution that settles the diagnosis is to take lymph node biopsy, either using needle biopsy or open excisional biopsy. Another site of lymphadenopathy is the groin. If you have a mass in the groin, which is the junctional area between the lower abdomen and upper thigh, please consider lymphadenopathy of the inguinal lymph nodes. Swellings at the groin, small swellings in particular, are called pubo. So pubo may be due to groin lymphadenopathy, sometimes may be due to subcutaneous lipoma, or saphenovarix, or hernia, etc., etc. Put into consideration the serious diagnosis of groin lymphadenopathy if you are confronted with a case of pubo, which is groin lymphadenopathy. Lymphoma may affect the skin, and the presentation is much like fungal skin infection. That's why it is called mycosis fungoides. As you see, it's a nodular, pigmented, scaly lesion, and the lesions are multiple and unite together, and it mimics exactly fungal infection. So give this patient just a 2-week trial of medical treatment. If no marked improvement occurred, please consider biopsy to exclude lymphoma of the skin. This is a lymphography that shows the thoracic duct, which lies on the left side of the front of the dorsal vertebra. And as I said before, it drains into the left side of the neck at the junction between the jugular vein and the subclavian vein. This condition is pleural effusion of the left side of the chest. We will discuss chest X-ray in another lecture, But in this case, observe the opacity here on the left side and compare it to the other side. This is the normal appearance of the lung, and this is the bronchovascular markings, and this is the right side of the heart. Here, there is opacity that masks the structures present in the thoracic cage on the left side. This opacity due to accumulation of pleural fluid. There is obliteration of the costophrenic angle by this fluid. And please also observe the upper surface or upper border of this fluid accumulation. Usually this upper border appears like raising towards the axilla. And this indicates that this is a pure fluid accumulation. If you have an air fluid level with transverse upper border of this collection, this is called hydrothorax with pneumothorax. So there is combination of hydro-pneumothorax. But in this particular case, the upper border of the fluid collection is rising to the axilla. The lower border, the medial border is lower than the lateral border. So the upper border is rising to the axilla. This is characteristic of pure pleural fluid accumulation. Tapping of this fluid to clarify its nature produced the following. This is milky fluid, and this milky fluid usually is called chylothorax. It may occur due to a lymphatic leak inside the pleural space, and this may be due to thoracic duct injury. This is a lymphography of the lymphatics in the pelvis and in the lumbar region. The other side, lymphatics of the pelvis and the lumbar region. Observe here the lymphatics in the upper lumbar region start to reflux at the region of the kidney. And this refluxing lymphatics in the kidney produce lymphatic leak inside the pelvic cell system. And patient may suffer from passage of this milky fluid with urine, the so-called chyluria. This is a very characteristic clinical picture. If your patient has chyluria, consider lumbar lymphatic leak inside the kidney. This is the end of this lecture. Please, if you have any comments, any questions, I will be glad to answer any question and to accept any comment and discuss anything you'd like. You can chat with me either on WhatsApp or send me a mail, or please you can send your comments on the medtube.net, and I hope the best of luck for all of you, and thank you.